All right, guys, welcome to church. Welcome, Emery, to the East Side service. Hope you're in fall break, right? Hope it's going well, you're getting some rest before you have to go right back into it, exams and things like that. But yeah, we're excited to worship together. Got some nice fall weather with us. And let's stand up together. Let me just open us up in a quick word of prayer and we'll get right into it. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for bringing us here. Lord, I just pray that us as a church that we can come together before you and just sing these songs, knowing that you're the God that always watches over us, that always cares for us. You're the one that gave us new life through your Son. And Lord, we just want to sing these songs to just glorify your name, Lord. Bless us in this time as we glorify you. Lord, thank you so much. Be with us. We worship you. Pray this all in your Son's name. Amen. Sing Christ alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song, his cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. As he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Oh, help in Christ alone. When fear assails, when darkness falls, I find my peace in Christ alone. I give my life, I give my all, I sing my song to Christ alone. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, all heaven sings to Christ alone, in Christ alone, in Christ for me are good. I know you hold my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Healing, freedom, you speak over me. Faith is breaking all impossibility. Your name has overcome, your name alone. I know your thoughts, your plans for me are good. I know you hold my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
Standing on every promise that you make, I will see it come to pass in your name, in
I am standing on every promise that you make. I will see it come to pass in your name, Jesus. I will trust every word I hear you say. I will see it come to pass in your name, I am standing on every promise that you make. I will see it come to pass in your name, Jesus. I will trust every word I hear you say. I will see it come to pass in your name, I am standing on every promise that you make. I will see it come to pass in your name, Jesus. I will trust every promise here you say. I will see it come to pass in your name, I will see it come to pass in your name, in your name. I will see it come to pass in your name, in your name. Your plans for me are good. I know you hold my future and my hope. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail. Your promises never fail.
Sing, God of Abraham.
God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, the faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun, setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
See, God from age to age,
God from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same, yeah. Your history can prove there's nothing you can do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word, I'll become to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
I put my faith
in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus,
my anchor
to the ground,
my hope
and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith
in Jesus.
He's my hope
to the ground.
He's my hope. never let me down. He'll never let me down. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness from the rising sun to the setting. Same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness from the rising sun. The setting, same, I will praise your name. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise. From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to
put my faith.
I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. He'll never let me down.
Lord, Heavenly Father, so we come together as a church, as your children, Lord, to just lift up the prayer, Lord, stating that you are our anchor, you are our hope and our foundation, God. And as we go and leave from this church, on to the next week, Lord Father, I just pray that you watch over us. And Lord, help us to never forget, Lord, that you are that foundation. And when we are happy, when we're sad, when we're struggling, or even thriving, Lord Father, help us, Lord, to just remember to rely on you and just look to you. And Lord, just bless the rest of this morning and just be with us. And in Jesus' name, pray.
Hello everyone, my name is Tommy. I am going to be giving you guys the announcements for today. If this is your first time here, I would like to extend a very special welcome to you. Thank you for joining us today. And if you wouldn't mind to just stick around after service, we have a special gift for you at the back by the welcoming table. We would love to just get connected with you a little bit more, plug you into our community, and just welcome you with a very special gift. So moving on, I will be giving you the first announcement, which is our one-year AMI-sponsored internships, which would be in the field as a missionary. So what this is basically you will serve alongside a full-time missionary somewhere in the world for a full year, and you will really just be able to experience God's glory and God's global purpose in this world. And to sign up, the signups are open until January 13th of next year, so you have plenty of time, multiple months. And there will also be an information meeting on November 6th on Zoom. More information for that will all be posted in our link tree at the end of the announcements. So be on the lookout if you feel called to serve, if you feel called to serve as a missionary in any way. Please just come. It's not a full commitment. This is just a time to learn more. But if you are really, really interested, we highly encourage you to go out and serve. So next, I'd like to take a little moment to talk about our campus prayer walks coming up. And these will be happening at the four campuses that JCA, our church, is a part of. That is Georgia Tech, Emory, GSU, and Oxford. So what's happening is, in place of prayer meeting next Friday, we will be having these prayer walks where students will be assembling at the designated locations behind me. And at around 7 p.m., we will go out and just pray for our campuses, our communities, and this will be happening next Friday. And then for Georgia State, this will be happening on Saturday morning at 11 a.m. So please be prepared. These are very meaningful, and each campus prayer walk will be paired with a deacon of our church. This will also be a time for the Eastside YA community to really get to know the college students a little bit better, just to, like, you know, connect with them, because here at our church, sometimes Midtown college students might feel like they're in a little bit of a bubble, and we just want to unite us a little bit more and show that we are one body in Christ. So next, I'd like to talk about the Clarkston Culture Fest happening two Saturdays from now, October 22nd, from 12 to 3 p.m. This is happening in lieu of the annual Trunk and Treat, so unfortunately Trunk and Treat got canceled, but this is an event that's taking place. It'll be happening at Indian Creek Elementary School, and it's again brought to you by City Hope Community, where we will be providing games and food for the children in, on this wonderful Saturday afternoon. And what City Hope is asking our church for is volunteers to help plan these games, to help host these games for these children as they come. And if you feel called to do so, if you feel called to serve, please fill out the Google form that will be located on the link tree at the end of the announcements. So finally, there is our college retreat coming up for Midtown. This is, I've talked about this multiple times now, but basically we will have our college fall retreat next, so three Saturdays from now, and this will be happening at FFA, which is a very nice venue that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And the theme for this retreat is Standing Firm in God's Grace. We will be exploring 1 Peter verse 5 through 12, and we have two amazing guest speakers for this retreat, one coming from Jubilee Church and another coming from the KCPC Church of Atlanta. Pastors Michael Chung and Peter Chong will be giving special sermons to the college students. So for colleges, if you are interested, please sign up. We are still opening signups. However, today is the last regular date of registration, where it will be $100 after tonight at midnight. That price will increase to $110. So we don't want you to miss out on any possible savings. However, if finances are a concern for you, we really don't want this to be a hindrance in any way. And so please reach out to eat@jcatlanta.org if you feel finances are a burden for you. And finally, just for YAs, for our young adults, if you feel called to serve in our college students in any way, either as a worship leader or a small group leader, please contact Pastor Minsu. This will be a great time for you to, again, get to know the college students better, but another great way to just show God's kingdom to our wonderful students. Please register now. So now I'll transition to a time that we call our Missions Minute. So this is a time when we highlight the missionary work that our wonderful partners are doing out in the field. We kind of share the good news that they have, and we spend a little time praying over them. However, today I have a very special Missions Minute, because I'll be lifting up our very own missionaries, because what I'd like to share is next Saturday there will be a special meet and eat before church, and this is a time where you can just come talk to our missionaries team, and it'll be also be a time to contribute financially. There will be a donation box open, and this is just a great time to both chat with our missionary team and also provide for them in a way that you can do. So there should be a link tree in the next slide behind me. If you take a few moments to scan this, it'll take you to all the links that I mentioned for all the events happening coming up this month for our church. If you feel interested in any way, I will highly encourage you to sign up, and I'll give you a few moments to do this. Okay, so now we'll transition into a time of offering. And at Journey Church of Atlanta, we do that through our Tithely app, which you can find on our website at jcatlanta.org, or you can download it through the App Store. I'll give you guys another few moments to do this, and then afterwards, I will pray us out. Father, thank you so much for this time we have to gather today to worship you, to hear your word, Lord. Thank you for this wonderful fall weather that you bring us. Thank you for just bringing us all here safely, Lord. I pray for the upcoming events for our church. I pray that whether it be the AMI internship, one-year missionaries, or the Clarkston Culture Festival, the college retreat coming up, or just the campus prayer walks that our Midtown students and YAs are participating in. I pray that you just show your glory and show your presence in all of these events, that we can just really experience you and just bring your kingdom to those around us. I pray that we can just glorify you so much through what we do in these events. I pray that we can just uplift each other, uplift you, Lord. I pray also for our church, Lord. I pray that you just convict us and just convict our hearts to serve, Lord, to serve and serve out of love, to serve and bring your kingdom closer to this earth, Lord. And finally, I pray for Pastor Dandy today as he gives the word to us. I pray that, it's not Pastor Dandy, is it? I pray for our pastor, Lord. I pray that he just is able to communicate so graciously and just so wonderfully, yet the word you have prepared for us, I pray that it falls on open hearts. I pray that you convict us again, that we just really are able to learn so much from you and then walk our lives in faith and love for you, Lord. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you for that lovely prayer. I'll never forget it. All right. It's all good. It happens, man. Let's turn to John 8. John 8, 1 to 31. If you have your Bibles with you physically, you might have to turn a page before. There's like one verse before that we'll cover as well. But for simplicity, let's turn to John 8, 1 to 11. Before I get into this, someone just texted me that the Tithely app is not working. Don't bother me with that. Ask Vincent. I don't know what to do. Go ask Vincent. Slack him. This is not an excuse for you to not tithe, but just bother him. I'm sure you guys could sort it out. Other than that, the text in itself, we want to cover. It's actually something I preached on about a couple years ago when we had COVID. And other than that, this text is actually, it's quite difficult to expound upon, because when you look into it, there's like a subscript that says that some of the earlier manuscripts do not actually have this story. And to the point where some of the commentators, they refused to expound on it. They said because it's not an authentic piece given by John. There's only like a very few commentaries that would actually talk about it. And the reason for it is some of the people that have studied this passage actually believe that I'm not really sure if I would agree with this, but they say that it's not authentic because it's in different pieces, or it's written in different parts of John. Some would actually say the story happens in John chapter 7, and others would say it happens later on in chapter 8. And because of the inconsistency People are prone to believe that John himself did not write this, but later traditions do include in it. And I think part of the reason is because it explains why Jesus is here at the Mount of Olives, and there's like a somewhat of a smooth transition into the rest of the text, in which I think Pastor Dandy will cover next week. And but to whether it happened or not, I truly do believe that it does give us a glimpse in terms of God's heart for his people, for us, and to be faithful to the text that is given. I am going to continue expounding on it, even if I shared it 2 years ago. I forgot what I talked about, I'm sure many of you. So it's a new lesson for all of us. So with that in mind, let's just go into study the text together, and I'll open us in prayer and go with the rest of worship. So John chapter 8. They went each to his own house, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say?" This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." Amen. Let's pray. Lord, you remind us that your mercies are new every morning. And as we gather into this place to worship you, may our response be out of your mercies and love for us that have started just even before we were born. So Lord, help us to cling on to that promise and the assurance that you have for us. And may you be freed of whatever burdens and condemnation that we may come forth bringing here today. So Lord, thank you, God. Praise your name. Amen. Early in my mid-20s, I would travel from Urbana-Champaign, Illinois, to Newport News, Virginia. I don't know if you guys are familiar with either areas, but it was basically about a 13-hour drive. And through this travel, I had two routes I could take. One was the wide path, where it's just a nice highway, it's very smooth, very comfortable. And then there was the narrow path, where it was in the middle of the mountains with forests and trees and with windy roads ahead. And without fail, I chose the narrow path, not because it was the biblical thing to do, but like I didn't want to pay the toll. So every time I would go this route and I would see traffic barriers or guardrails, and I would wonder what was the purpose of those things, and I realized it was so that no one would get off course. So in the event that someone's speeding or slips or whatever, for safety precautions, those guardrails are set in place so that no one would essentially fall off the cliff. And, you know, it's a very dangerous path to begin with. And when I think about laws in general, not just biblical laws, but any laws, I'm reminded of those guardrails. Because just like those guardrails, God gifts us with certain laws to essentially protect us from going off track or going off way far off course, where we know that if we go beyond that line, that will lead to essentially death and destruction. And without those proper barriers, we essentially lose our way. And it's a good signal as to say, if we're getting too close to these laws, we need to turn around, we need to repent and get back in track. But to be honest, there's some of us who are the more adventurous type, who are willing to go cross that line and essentially break the laws that God has instituted for us. And when we look at this passage, we see two camps, right? There are those, or there's this woman caught in adultery who has passed that law and who has passed that line and has broken one of God's laws. But there are those who, in a way, chose not to go beyond that line. But even for them, they have lost sight of what's truly important here. That laws in itself, there's a grander purpose, and I'll go into that later. And that's the Pharisees and the scribes here. And what Jesus does throughout the story is that he restores both camps. And even us today, as we read this passage, we may resonate with either camp, but it's the same message where, for us, where Jesus restores us towards the right track of salvation. And that's my main idea. Jesus restores us on the right track of salvation. And it's the salvation that comes from the Old Testament law and salvation that comes from the New Testament grace. So salvation from the Old Testament law. Before I go into that, when we look at this passage, verses 1 and 3, it gives us the context, the background of what's going on, where Jesus is teaching with a crowd, and there's the scribes and Pharisees, they come in and they interrupt what Jesus has to say. And all the purpose of wanting to shame him. And they, in a way, they catch him off guard. And they do this wanting to trap him. And they make a challenge with this difficult question, what we see in verses 4 and 5. Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such woman. So what do you say? So when they ask this question, we first got to ask, which use of the law, or what law are they trying to apply? Which law are they trying to use? And it goes back to Leviticus 20:10, Deuteronomy 22:22, where it says, if a man commits adultery with the wife of his neighbor, both the adulterer and the adulteress shall be put to death. And Deuteronomy 22, it says the same thing. If a man is found lying with the wife of another man, both of them shall die. And the Pharisees and scribes, they bring this law up to Jesus, and they're asking, hey, this is a situation. We caught someone that has been blatantly cheating. What do you think we should do? And for Jesus to say, well, let's punish her for what she has done. Well, if he were to say that, then it undermines everything that he has been teaching when it comes to forgiveness, mercy, and grace. And for him to say, let's punish her politically, that stirs up trouble because at the time, it was only the Roman prefects that had the full authority to punish people through death. But if you were to say the opposite and has to say, hey, let's forgive her, then what it's portraying is that Jesus does not care about the law. He is a lawless man. He disobeys to God. And so with those two options, it's a challenge of what is he supposed to do? But the reason why it's also a challenging question is because actually the scribes and Pharisees, they're misusing the law. They have forgotten what the intent and purpose of God's laws are in the first place. First, even in the spirit of the law, they misuse it because this law, the Leviticus and Deuteronomy laws, the purpose and intent is for God's people to be his kingdom priests, where God lays out what's unholy and lays out what's holy so that people know which direction to go, how to avoid what is unholy, how to do what is right, where obedience leads to blessings and disobedience leads to death. But they misuse it because instead of seeking his kingdom purposes, they use it for punishment, to have a public outcry of shame rather than prevent her of sin. And that also leads to abuse of the law. And I think misuse and abuse, they could intertwine in certain ways, but abuse is more of the intent of selfish gain, of where the motive is for selfish gain. And that's what they're trying to do. The text here says, they said this law, in verse 6, they said this law to test him, that they may have some charge to bring against him. And for them, it's really not about holiness. It's not about fulfilling God's intent. What it's really about is bringing Jesus down. It's about shaming this one individual to exploit the sin rather than really prevent it. And for this adulterous woman, she's put on this public display in this theological debate where the word of God is used to attack her. When actually the word of God, even to this day, the purpose and heart is to give hope, to bring redemption. But in here, it's used for someone's own selfish agenda, self-righteousness. And it's used for deceit and entrapment. And they sacrifice her reputation. And one thing I actually forgot to talk about is when we look at the original laws of Deuteronomy and Leviticus, it is clear in the letter of the law that both shall be put to death. So even when I look at the story, my question is, where's the dude? Where is the guy in this situation? And no one really knows. Either he ran away, or the scribes here, they were so prejudiced against this one individual that they were ready to attack her rather than restore or to help her. But they misapply their laws for their own agenda. And that's why Jesus comes in and he answers with the proper use of the law. And he says in verse 7, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And in actuality, what Jesus is saying is in reference to Deuteronomy 13 and 9 and 17:7, where both law says, your hand shall be the first against him, the adulterer, to put him to death. And afterwards, the hand of all the people, the hand of the witness shall be the first against him to put him to death. So meaning, if you really want to apply the letter of the law here, this should have been settled a while ago. Why are you bringing the charge to me? Well, and essentially, that's what Jesus is saying. And what he's not saying is that if you really want to throw or cast stones of judgment, you yourself have to be perfect before you could judge that person or to rebuke or correct or whatnot. And he's not saying that perfection is the qualifier in terms of rebuke and correction. But what he's saying is that what he's really exposing here is the hypocrisy that's happening. Like I said, there aren't too many commentators who talk about this story, but there's one I found out of 50. D.A. Carson, he puts it like this. I don't know if I fully agree, but he says that you must not be guilty of this particular sin. And he says this is because at the cultural context of the time, it was normally the adulteress that was put to shame and faced the harsh legal consequences of the time. And for the adulterer, he could continue living in sin like a normal life, and there will be no punishment that is applied to him. But again, there was this double standard that Jesus is bringing out. I don't know if I particularly agree with what Carlson has said, only because I don't know the cultural context of the time. But when I read the text, it does not say, let him who is without this particular sin. No, it says without sin. So I'm more prone to believe. But either way, what I do believe is that there is a sense of hypocrisy that Jesus brings out from the crowd, where he's saying to them, you yourselves engage in sinful activities when you know that you shouldn't, but there's blame and outright anger to others who are doing the same exact thing as you are. Because when they do wrong, you demand correction. You demand justice. You demand to make things right. But what about when you do wrong? What is it that you ask? And as I think about this, I'm actually reminded of another story in the Old Testament. When you look at 2 Samuel 12, you see that story of the famous passage of David and Nathan. And what had happened prior to this is that David, he not only does he commit adultery with Bathsheba, but he essentially tries to cover it up, tries to hide this sin. And he even murders or places Bathsheba's former husband into the front lines of battle. So he essentially murders this guy. And then we get to 2 Samuel 12, and Nathan comes to him with this story saying there once lived two different men. One was rich, one was poor. And the poor man had this baby lamb, and it was like a child to him. But one day, the rich man, who had all the flock of sheep, however he wanted, although he had so much, he decided to take this poor man's sheep for himself and to offer as a meal to a guest. And Nathan's question is, you know, what should be done? And David's response is actually anger and contempt, and he says, this man deserves to die. And Nathan's response to David is, you are this man. And it's, again, it's that sense of hypocrisy that's happening. And I think, to just bring it even in our lives, I think a question we could ask is, at what point, when we see others in sin, what is it that drives us to anger? Where rather than compassion or to just even think about the aspects that people are struggling, at what point do we come to a place of anger and say, they need to be punished? Where certain leaders of our church, they struggle with sin and say, they shouldn't be serving anymore. They need to come down. They need to, I don't know, be punished in a certain way. And then we ourselves, when we're serving in different capacities, we may struggle with a different sin or maybe even the same sin. But when we do wrong, we have a different attitude, right? It's like, essentially, we'll probably say, please don't punish me. Please show me grace. But when we come into that attitude, do we see that sense of hypocrisy? Now, don't get me wrong, I'm all for church discipline, like that's great. But at the end of the day, where is the restoration? Where is compassion? And the issue that we see with the scribes and Pharisees dragging this woman into public shame, it's the same question. Where is the compassion? Where is that message of grace? When they themselves distribute grace among themselves, but they see someone else in pain and in shame, they're willing to easily deny and take that away. And all the more, Christ comes to protect this individual. And all the more reason why we have forgiveness, grace, and mercy. And that brings me to my second point, where there's salvation from New Testament grace. And we see Jesus redeeming the woman caught in adultery, where he releases her from shame, from guilt, and fear, and he shows what it means to forgive. I think there are four lessons of forgiveness here. Is that first, Jesus always takes the initiative. He addresses the woman first, and he says, woman. I think there needs to be some cultural explanation here. When we say it's like woman, it sounds derogatory. But actuality, the Greek word, gene, it's a tone that is gentle and that is respectful. And he's approaching her, and he asks her this question, has no one condemned you? See, he doesn't come up and say, you need to confess right now. He's not saying, shame on you. How could you let this happen? But there is that sense of genuine gentleness, care, concern. And what we see is that his objective is forgiveness. Because we worship a God who is compassionate, who cares. And it's that same message from all we've heard through John in like the last 8 months, where look at all of John chapter 3. And verse 17 says, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. His objective is forgiveness and salvation. And he, if you look at this story further, He did not have to intervene. He could have just said, this is not my business. Go to your law people to take care of it. But if he did that, that only meant death for this one individual. But he comes in and he forgives. He saves her life, literally. And for it, and it's, again, it's the same message for every sinner here, where when we come to Jesus, he has that same message. Neither do I condemn you. And in response to that, their lesson of forgiveness. After forgiveness, after Jesus forgives, he calls for obedience. And it's not the other way around. That says, you obey first and I will forgive you. No, this person, this individual who has received forgiveness, her response out of that is obedience. Where Jesus says, go and from now on sin no more. Again, he's not demanding perfection. But now that you have received mercy in your life, turn away from this life of sin. I mean, that's repentance. And he's saying, you have been given the second chance. What will you do with it? And he's urging and calling to turn away from that sin. Sin no more. And because of that mercy, you can turn away and repent of that sin. And lastly, Jesus, the lesson of forgiveness. Jesus is the only one with the authority to forgive. Where it says, again, neither do I condemn you. For him to actually say that, it's basically saying that he himself is God, because only God is in the business of forgiving sins. And he doesn't just say it to say like, hey, I'm God, so you're clean. But he backs up his words with action. And because ultimately that is through the cross. Because when we look at the Old Testament, any worshiper that wanted to be forgiven had to come to the altar with an unblemished animal, spotless animal. And that animal would pay with its own life, pays for the worshiper's sin. That was the cost, the life of the animal. And essentially, in the shedding of its blood, the animal died in the place of the worshiper, because the worshiper himself, because of his sins, should have deserved death. But in this ceremony, the animal itself bore the cost. And when we think about what Jesus does on the cross, it's that same message, where he takes the shame, the guilt, and the sins of that particular woman, and he pays it for her, pays for her forgiveness to the cross. He can say, neither do I condemn you, saying he could say, I forgive you, because he lives it up through his own actions, through the cross.
Never save a sinner's soul. But my God says to the prodigal, my beloved one, you're welcome home. Your mercy triumphs over judgment. Love wider than horizons, stronger than all sin. Lord, your kindness leads us to repentance, to the heart. All I want, and all to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. And I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. And all to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. Your mercy triumphs over judgment. Love wider than horizons, stronger than all sin. Lord, Your kindness, oh, it leads us to
sing Amazing Love.
Amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving. You're so good, God, You're so good. Yes, God, You're so good, You're so good to me. Dead are raised, the sinner saved, work of Your power, God, You're so good, God, You're so good, oh God, You're so so good to me.
sing, God, you're so good.
God, you're so good. Oh, God, you're so good. Yes, God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
I am blessed.
I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. I am blessed. I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. Should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. Oh God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. God, God, you're so good. Yes, God, you're so good. You're so good to me. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Let's on to the promises that you have for us.